Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we'd like to start the show off today. We have two very, very large recalls. Ram is recalling, 1.4 million trucks. The 2019 through 2022 model year. And there may be a problem with the tailgate not latching properly and could possibly open while driving. And we have a Subaru recall. You don't see many of those from Subaru, but 287,000 accents have a fire risk. Now, Dave, you're more literate than I am on the workings of an automobile, so you can tell me where this happens to be located. The positive temperature coefficient heater connections may have been improperly fastened, so you could possibly have a fire, and it's the ground for that.
Well, I think that's under the rear seat, Roosevelt.
If you say so. I don't know.
Yeah, owners should check under the, should park the car and check under the rear seat. Yeah.
But they're saying do not park the car in any or close to any structures, and do not leave the car running because there's a possibility of a fire. And as I always say, please visit the website of the manufacturer, or you can go to NHTSA.gov. That's the National Highway Traffic and Safety Administration. Enter your VIN number and see if your vehicle is under recall.
Roosevelt, always,
go ahead.
I was going to say, you mentioned Subaru and then you mentioned Accent. And Hyundai builds the Accent.
I'm sorry. I wrote down the wrong name. Sorry. I apologize. I have to get that. The Ascent. Is it the Ascent? The
Ascent. Yeah.
Ascent, not Accent. There we go.
And that's also about a $20,000 price point difference. So
right.
Yeah. But
thank you for that correction.
Sure, happy to do it. And I would also mention on the Ram recall,
That
tailgate thing is only important if you carry something in your bed of the Ram pickup, and most Ram owners don't. So it's probably a recall that most Ram owners could ignore.
Oh, don't do that. Don't tell people to ignore recalls. And we're trying to get as many people to take care of recalls as possible. There's still millions of vehicles out there under recall. So regardless of how minor they are.
Unless your 10-year-old twins are in the bed, don't worry about the tailgate coming unlatched.
Okay, you can please ignore that previous comment. All recalls are important, so please take care of them. But anyway, moving right along, Dave, what are you driving? What do you want to talk about?
After a couple of weeks in which I've been in Cadillacs, and certainly nothing wrong with the Cadillac brand, although the XT4 at the one end was considerably less pleasing than the Escalade was at the top end. I think the Escalade plays the role of a big SUV far better than the XT4 plays the role of a compact crossover. This week, I'm in Alfa Romeo's Stelvio, which is Alfa's take on the compact midsize crossover. And I'll tell you what, it is an absolute delight to drive. If given the choice of a Giulia four-door sedan or the Alfa Stelvio, I'd be strongly interested in the Giulia sedan because I like sports sedans. But I'll tell you what, for somebody that needs a degree of practicality in combination with a sports sedan-like feel for $60,000, you'd be hard-pressed to do any better than the Alfa Romeo Stelvio.
I think they did. Alfa had a media drive. Was it in Italy or was it in Spain recently?
Well, I haven't gotten out of Northern Virginia, Roosevelt.
Oh, so I don't know. I thought maybe you'd read about it someplace. I can't.
But was that the, I was going to say, in the absence of an invitation, if Alfa could just send me the bullet point presentation that they showed to the invited journalists, I'd love that. But was that on the Tonale, the new subcompact?
I don't remember.
Okay,
fair enough. Probably should not have even mentioned it since I don't remember what it was.
Well, and if Alfa Romeo is watching, let them know I'm not irritated, Roosevelt, at the lack of an invitation. I just, as I said, would enjoy the bullet points. But today we have Frank Washington with us anyway.
Frank has joined us. Hey, Frank.
Gentlemen, how you doing?
Good. About yourself?
Just trying to fight off this cold.
Uh-oh. So what are you driving to stay warm? What's your review for today?
I've got a RAV4.
Okay.
Today. And it's cold, it's raining, and it's a great vehicle for that kind of weather. Just about any vehicle is, particularly all-wheel drive. Because a lot of people, I won't say a lot of people, but it's easy to forget that, you know, rain equals slick roads, particularly when you've got oil, you know, and that sort of stuff. But the RAV is, you know, it's like a bread and butter car or vehicle, I should say. You know, it's quick enough, stylish. It's got all the, at least the one I've got, has all the bells and whistles, you know, in terms of heated seats, heated steering wheel, you know, and I'm really beginning to fall in love with those.
Yeah,
especially heated steering wheels.
Yeah, the steering wheel. The seats, you know, I've always said that, you know, coming up when I was a young man, I had heated seats. We called them coats.
Coats.
Yeah.
I mean, back in the day, Frank, I used to call them dates.
Yeah, that too. Yeah. But you know, as I said, it's got all the bells and whistles. Really great. You know, acceleration wasn't bad. Mileage was good. But no, I was a little disappointed with the mileage, at least with this with the stated mileage, because they were saying it got something like 24. Yeah, I think it was 24 miles per gallon. And I thought, you know, for a small vehicle with a relatively small engine, they could have done a little bit better than that. I think hybrids do a lot better. You know, a hybrid does a lot better. But other than that, you know, not a panoramic roof, but it did have a sunroof. So, you know, it was a... It was and is much appreciated.
Yeah. I'm like you, Frank. I have become very appreciative of any car that I get when the temperature drops a little bit now. It has, especially a heated steering wheel. That's one of the first things I look for.
Yeah. Well, this was on the Cadillac, and I think it's on the Stelvio. Are we now seeing heated seats and wheels that are coming on automatically based on outside temperatures?
No,
it definitely happened.
No, what I'm seeing is heated seats and wheels, steering wheels. Let's be clear.
Yeah.
Heated seats and steering wheels. That when you turn them on, when you turn the vehicle off, and then turn it back on, they stay on.
Okay, interesting. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And they don't stay on all models, because I've had a couple and it didn't happen. But the one that I'm driving now that I'll talk about, they did stay on.
Yeah.
Which I found interesting.
And it's a measure of aging, I know. And yeah. I hate to go there.
Yeah.
But I've always been dismissive of the heated steering wheel, even in northern climes. I mean, if you want warmer hands, put on a pair of gloves. But the one hand's arthritic. The other hand is jacked because of a bicycle accident 6 months ago. And suddenly those heated wheels feel very comfortable. It's like having your own therapist.
Yes.
And that's a good thing.
Well, let me get into the vehicle that I'm in. This is the 2023 Honda. It's a Honda as well, Frank, the HRV, the five-door all-wheel drive. This is the EXL model, which is an upgrade, has a 2-liter four-cylinder engine, 158 horsepower, 138 pound-feet of torque, and it has that transmission that everybody loves, that CVT. I love this exterior color. It's a Nordic forest pearl is what it's called. Interior is gray. And I'm like you, Frank. This one, I'm not impressed with the fuel economy. It's 25 in the city, 30 on the highway, and 27 combined. You know, I would think that they could have bumped that up a tad for the size of this vehicle. It has a good MSRP, $30,590. It has a nice looking exterior, as you can see. I've been paying more attention now to night driving, like we were talking about, Dave, with the heated seat and the steering wheel. It has automatic high beams, which is a nice feature.
Mm-hmm.
As you can see, it has quite a bit of storage space, hidden storage space as well. So if you want to have some things that are of value, you can stick them in there. It has something that kind of shocked me. It came on because I haven't had this to happen in the car yet. It has a driver attention monitor. It came on, a little audible came on, and a graphic came up that said, you know, you need to start paying attention or pull over and rest, something to that effect.
Okay.
which I said, wait a minute, I've been looking straight ahead as long as I've been driving this thing. Where did this come from? But it kind of shocked me that just popped up. And this vehicle also have multiple driving modes, which is something else that I'm starting to get into. And, you know, multiple driving modes have been around for a while, but they're getting better when you go into a different drive mode. They're actually giving you some changes that you can feel and appreciate rather than just flipping a switch and it says sport and nothing happens.
Right.
Have you been in this?
The HRV, correct?
Right.
Yeah, I have. And I was very impressed with everything but the off-the-line acceleration. And to my way of thinking, the car absolutely screams for a hybrid. And I've not read that a hybrid in the HRV is coming. Just as if someone's buying a RAV4, Toyota does not bump the window sticker up too much to get the RAV4 hybrid. And suddenly you're going from the mid-20s in terms of efficiency to the mid-30s in terms of efficiency. So that would pay itself back pretty darn quickly. But I sure liked the way the HRV was styled, and I sure liked the way the interior is trimmed out for $30,000.
Yeah, I was just a little disappointed. The nav screen to me could have been a little bit bigger. And see, other than that, for the price point and what it is, you know, I found it easy to drive. It handled well. It rode well. So I didn't have any real complaints.
I also missed the magic seat of its the last gen HRV. That was a folding rear seat that really would allow you to get a love seat in the back of the thing or a dishwasher if you were so inclined. Right. And this, with the conventional folding seat, still allows you to stuff quite a bit of stuff, but it doesn't give you the flexibility that last generation HRV gave you.
Okay. Got a couple of things I want to, hopefully we can talk about today. And Dave, be nice.
I'm always nice to you guys.
Always have to add that caveat.
Frank, has there ever been a time when I've not been nice to you?
I have never experienced Dave being anything other than a gentleman.
Thank you, Mr. Washington.
Okay. Send him his $2, Frank. I'm sure you all have heard about the Hyundai, the Ioniq 6 EV that's going to hit the marketplace. Supposedly 340-mile range, 324 horsepower. And they just seem to be, Hyundai seems to be pumping out those Ioniqs. What, they have a 5, they have a 6. And did I hear that there's a 7 coming, something along those lines?
It would not surprise me.
But they're just pumping out some new product. And we have, a couple weeks ago, the Toyota introduced the new Prius.
Yes.
Which has been a rave, I guess. If you've seen any of my comments or videos about it. I said that Toyota finally took the ugly out of the Prius.
Right.
So it's a much better looking vehicle. And it performs well. You know, they bumped up the horsepower, I think, to something like 198 horsepower. And it has quite a bit of space. I found that the design for me getting in and out, I think I bumped my head a couple of times, but
it is low roof line. It is a little low, and yeah. you are a above average individual in terms of height, right?
Right.
Yeah. 5'7" is average, by the way.
Yeah, you could slide in there with no problem.
Have they put the Prius? Can you build one on their website yet and price one?
I haven't been on their website. Okay. I'm sure you can.
Yeah, yeah. Do you have an idea of what the price point is or the price ranges are?
It's somewhere around $35,000.
Okay.
In that area. Yeah, I think they just came out with some pricing.
Yeah, $30,000 to $35,000.
Yeah.
Because there are three trim lines. So depending on which trim you get.
Right.
I think the top trim line is about $35,000 and the one in the middle is 32.
And are they offering a plug-in yet? Plug-in hybrid?
Not yet.
No.
Okay, fair enough.
And I'm surprised that, well, I guess I'm not surprised, but I've seen a lot of journalist reviews and they were talking about the looks of the vehicle. It seems like Toyota may have won that battle in terms of the looks, which is the first step to get somebody to even want to take a test drive. You know, you always see the exterior first. But I thought it had a very nice design to it. So
I did too.
Yeah. From what I've seen photographically, I'd like to have one in my driveway at least for a week.
Yeah. And what's the fuel economy? Still around 50, I believe, somewhere in that area.
It was
more than that?
I think it was like close to 59.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the Corolla hybrid, I'm remembering, is being 50-ish.
Well, it's like 50.
50? That's what I thought it was, around 50. Yeah, but other than that, it's I think they, what I've seen Toyota talk about in terms of future sales, they kind of plan it down in terms of sales for the new Prius. They don't think that it's going to, you know, break any sales records. So they're kind of being conservative in what they expect the numbers to be.
Well, you know, I think, forgive me for cutting you off.
Go right ahead.
I didn't mean to. But they talked a little bit about, in a lot of ways, they don't know. Let's put it that way, because when the Prius first came out, it had to market all to itself. There was nothing else out there, no hybrid anyway. I once said that the Prius single-handedly dragged the entire industry into hybrids.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you were a manufacturer and you didn't have a hybrid, what says, you know, that you didn't care about mileage, you didn't care about the economy. You know, if you didn't have a hybrid, there was nothing positive. So even if you didn't believe in the technology, you had to have a hybrid to show, as a matter of fact, you had to have a hybrid in a way to be a good corporate citizen.
You know, sometimes when you're the only one in a space, you don't have any push to do anything better or different faster. You know, now, like with EVs now, everybody is coming out with an EV. Tesla kind of owns, well, Tesla still owns the luxury EV space, even though most people don't consider them a luxury vehicle. It's just an expensive EV is what you normally see when you talk about Teslas. But you can say what you want. They have forced the manufacturers to get into the EV space. But like you said, Frank, when the Prius first came out, they were just sitting there. I mean, they to me, the Prius and the Leaf should have just dominated the market in terms of advancements, you know, moving in from hybrids to plug-in hybrids to EVs, and that just didn't happen.
And we could do an entire show or month of shows on the missteps Nissan has made over the last 15 years in terms of product development. But the fact that they fumbled the Leaf EV to the extent that they did, I mean, it just amazes me that they could have been the viable alternative to Elon Musk and his Tesla, and instead just essentially went away. They continued building it, but no one was paying attention. And even today, with the new Araya, is it launched? Is it about to launch? I'm not sure they're getting anybody's attention, even with it, which is obviously vastly improved over what the Leaf was at its end.
Yeah, I always say that I'll call the traditional manufacturers were at and are still at a disadvantage because they're producing ICE vehicles as well as trying to be, trying to produce EVs that can compete in the market space. But then you have the new manufacturers that have come into the market. They're just focusing on EVs, which gives them a total advantage. But what they are lacking is a dealer network in terms of sales and service. So we're going to see what happens in that space.
Yes. Yeah, Rivian, here in Northern Virginia, we're seeing quite a few of the Rivian pickups. But I think you have to go to Richmond to take delivery, which is a 2.5 hour drive. And while Tesla has their regional service centers and a retail model, which we've alluded to, that I think is mall-based, as much as anything, you can find where to buy a Tesla and you can find where to get a Tesla service. But with the new Lucids, Rivians, those people, it could be months, if not years, before those become readily apparent, at which point they may or may not have money and operating capital to stay in business.
Well, I think traditional auto dealers, and I think in last week we kind of touched on it. General Motors dealers are now starting to service Teslas. And since we all know that there's still a chip shortage, there's still COVID going on in the marketplace, and please wash your hands, wear your mask, stay 6 feet apart, that service is a viable revenue stream for these dealers. I know, yeah. Tesla may be a competitor, but those cars need to be repaired. And there are a lot of them out there that have no real place, like you said, close to them, like Lucid, Rivian, for instance.
Yeah. Where would you find it?
Yeah. Why not go to be able to take it to a local dealer and the dealer gets that service money, which pretty much pays for the dealership anyway. That's where the bulk of their revenue comes from.
Yeah. At $140 an hour.
Yeah,
it certainly does. Yeah.
So, you know, that can justify adding 20 more service bays just to pick up business from those manufacturers that don't have service centers that are close to most people.
I'd convert my living room into a service bay if I could make $140 an hour.
Yeah. Well, I think if, you know, there's some probably some very aggressive entrepreneurs that are going to start putting vans together and go to, drive 2 hours to service that Rivian.
Yeah.
I think you're going to see that, you know, a lot of dealers were doing that. They were driving out to people's home when COVID was rampant rather than having the customer come into the dealership to do some of the service repair. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens along those lines. But on a lighter note, I don't know whether you are a Lego builder from years ago, but Lego has built an F-150 Lightning full-size model, and it has working lights. So I wonder what that costs. So you can park it and have it, pull it in your driveway and have the lights come on.
Yeah, I missed Lego completely, and I have an affection for what the company does and the number of fans that they have. But I was building 125th scale AMT models in the back of my folks' Dodge wagon, unrestrained. seats were folded.
Yeah, right.
And that's what I did on family vacations, was build 125th AMTs. The Legos, I think, in the back seat of a wagon would have just been all over the place. I don't think it could have been controlled.
But I'm amazed at what people and what Lego, especially Lego, the, you know, what they've been able to build with those Lego parts. It's just, it's unbelievable. And if you look at a picture, you know, it's kind of hard to tell whether it's not smooth or not.
Right, right.
You know,
heck of a business model.
Yeah, they do a great job. Dave, this is for you. Well, both of you. You know, I'm sure you have feral cats running around your neighborhood.
No.
Yes, you do. You may not see them or not, but this is the time of the year where they look to warm themselves on top of your tires or under your hood. So there's a warning going out now on the people in cold weather areas. Please, please, please look out for the cats that need to warm themselves under your car or under the hood. So check and don't kill them. That's what they're asking you to do. Please don't kill the cats.
Is there a recall notice on those?
There could be. There could be. I know around my house there are quite a few running around. So
yeah, we've got foxes and squirrels.
Oh, okay.
And I'm thinking the foxes may keep the feral cat population at bay, right, so to speak.
Right.
But I'll keep my eyes peeled for a fox that's warming itself on one of my tires.
And the squirrel would probably eat the wiring. Are they still having problems with that? Remember the wiring was made out of these vegetable type products? And
Yeah. Well, at this time of year, I think it was David Letterman, the squirrels are spending most of their time just warming their nuts.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's David Letterman, folks. Write the letters to him. Yeah.
Right. Well, GM is testing consumer charging at some of their dealerships, which I think is a great idea. You know, I don't know why they didn't jump on this a long time ago. But as we know, charging stations are still hard to find in a lot of places. So GM is testing having what they call dealer public or dealer community charging stations. So you'll be able to pull in, not disrupt the dealership, to charge your vehicle, which I think is a great idea. It's going to be interesting to see how fast they roll this out. To me, there's no need of having a pilot or a test program. We all know that there's a shortage of charging stations.
We discuss Automotive News, the trade publication, with some frequency on this show. And I'm a religious reader of Automotive News and have a great deal of respect for what they do. But one of their headlines in last week's pub noted that EVs, there's not the excitement for EVs in the Midwest that there is on the coasts. And again, that's really a headline you didn't need to write. We all know that there's not the excitement, in large part by virtue of the lack of charging, in large part because the marketing emphasis is typically on the coasts. But yeah, to my way of thinking, if you're a Cadillac GMC dealer in the middle of Iowa, and you were to install some charging stations in the middle of Iowa, suddenly you'd see some EV adaptation in the middle of Iowa. So it would seem like a no-brainer, just as the headline seemed like a no-brainer.
Right.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you all have been following the hydrogen situation, but there seems to be now a push to have more hydrogen fuel cell vehicles out there in the marketplace. And do you know that there's a whopping 54 in the United States fueling stations for hydrogen cars? Now that's the pilot program.
You kind of wonder. You're seeing a lot of municipalities, and Frank, I don't know if you see this in Detroit or not, but moves among municipalities to electrify their bus fleets.
Right.
Yeah. And to my way of thinking, the fuel cell, if that had an application for anybody, it would be for school buses and municipal buses, and have those refueling stations at those transportation centers before you worry about cars and the general public. I don't know.
I think that's a great application for buses.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Or taxis.
Yeah.
Right. You know? Right. Well, taxis are pretty much gone away in a lot of places because of all the Ubers and the Lyft type programs. But if you want to, you know, cut fuel costs.
Well, and the post office after that, whatever you want to call it, it's probably not polite for the podcast to call it what I want to call it. But the post office was originally going to replace their fleet or a large portion of their fleet with gas powered vans.
Right.
And this being 2022, somebody woke up and said, well, why don't you get electrified vans instead, which apparently they are now doing. And again, I think you could have made an argument for 90,000 fuel cell vans that can be refueled at the postal services themselves after a day's run or potentially a week's run, given whatever the range happens to be.
Yeah, because so, I think, go ahead.
Just a lot of applications that can be started and get the ball rolling before you have to draw in the consumer and hope that 300 million people can get their fuel cell vehicles recharged out of 54 refueling stations.
Yeah, because those vehicles are pretty much on the move all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so refueling is, the cost of fuel is a major expense.
Right, right.
You know, to those type programs or those type vehicle. So you would, yeah, I would agree with you. You would think that they would take something like a hydrogen.
Was the cost of our stamps for individual mail goes close to a buck. I hope maybe they take a look at that just to keep
it. I don't think so. But anyway, I want to thank you all for taking the time to listen to and view Auto Network Reports. I'm not going to say it. Yes, I will. The award-winning podcast.
Podium finish.
It's coming up in the next day or two. Please subscribe to the web. I can't even get my words out. Please subscribe to the website of each one of the panelists. Show them some love. Also, if you know an African American that's 30 years or older, please make sure he visits his urologist and get that PSA exam. It's that little prick that could possibly save his life. Any final comments, guys?
No, not for me.
Just bye, huh?
See you. Well, I remind people that I've always been nice to Frank. And also, I would mention, no one ever asks me what I'm watching, but I'm watching the Harry and Meghan thing on Netflix. And I'd encourage all of you to watch it yourself.
Moving right along. Frank, I made another mistake.
What?
Ask for a final comment.
That's it. No, I'm not watching.
I had no idea that they came from such dissimilar backgrounds. No idea.
But anyway, we just have too much fun on this show. I think maybe we should stick to automotive. But as always, folks, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Please buckle up. Don't text and drive. And as Frank says, please buckle up and don't stream and drive. Have a safe weekend, guys. See you next time. Thanks for viewing.
Be good, everybody.
Take care.
Thanks, Frank.